You have to bear with me. My throat's not doing so well tonight. In Titus chapter number 1, we see here this epistle that the Apostle Paul is writing to Titus. Titus is a younger pastor, preacher, and he's given him some instructions here, and we see also some of the qualifications for being a pastor or bishop. The two are used interchangeably, pastor, elder, and bishop. In this passage, elder and bishop are actually just used interchangeably. You can see that verse 5, he says, "For this cause I left I thee in Crete, that thou shouldest set in order the things that are wanting and ordain elders in every city as I had appointed thee." And then in verse 7, he says, "For a bishop must be blameless." So we see there he's talking about ordaining elders and refers to them as bishops. It's the same office. There's two offices held in the New Testament. There's either you call it a bishop, an elder, or a pastor. They're all the same office. It's just another word for the same exact position. And then you have deacons. And we see that in 1 Timothy chapter 3 also, which I think we're going to that a little bit later tonight. But in Titus chapter 1, he says, "This is the reason, Titus, that I left you in Crete, because you need to set in order the things that are wanting," which means the things that are lacking. You know, there's still stuff that needs to be done, "and ordain elders in every city as I had appointed thee." See, they were going around preaching the gospel, getting people saved, and I believe starting up these churches. Right, you got new believers because they've gone out into the Gentiles and you know, gone out to these new nations, preaching the gospel of Christ, getting a whole bunch of people saved and getting them kind of established and started with churches. But they continued to move on and move on and move on. But they didn't just forget about those churches. They went back and he said, "Okay, now we need to go back through and you need to ordain elders now, because they need to have one person who's in charge. They need to have someone who's leading the flock and someone who meets the qualifications." And that's what he goes into in verse 6. "If any be blameless, the husband of one wife, having faithful children, not accused of riot or unruly. For a bishop must be blameless as the steward of God, not self-willed, not soon angry, not given to wine, no striker, not given to filthy lucre, but a lover of hospitality, a lover of good men, sober, just, holy, temperate." All these various attributes he's just describing, you know, this is what you're looking for when you're ordaining elders. They need to fit this mold. These are the characteristics that they must have in order to be ordained an elder. Look at verse number 9, "holding fast the faithful word as he hath been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and to convince the gainsayers." And what I'm going to be preaching about this evening, the title of my sermon is called "Whose Mouths Must Be Stopped," which is there found there in verse number 11. We haven't gotten quite that far down yet. And I'm going to be tying in basically the role of a pastor, one of the roles of a pastor. There's many roles that a pastor plays in you know, leading a church and directing a church. But there are people whose mouths need to be stopped, and they need serious rebuke, and it needs to be public, and people need to be called out for preaching false doctrine, for spreading a bunch of lies, and the lies get so bad that they actually are subversive towards other people. You know, these false gospels that are preached are sending people to hell. It's not just talking about any little difference, some difference of opinion or some difference in a doctrine that's a different understanding, but not like some major deal. This is talking about subversion, subverting people and causing a lot of damage. So let's see there in verse number 9 again, "holding fast the faithful word as he hath been taught," excuse me. And there's an emphasis here on retaining good, sound doctrine. The people who are being ordained as elders should have already been taught and trained and established as receiving sound doctrine. They've been going through and receiving from other teachers the sound doctrine that you need to have, and then being faithful. He says, "holding fast the faithful word as he hath been taught." And the faithful word coming, of course, from God's holy word, the Holy Scriptures. "And may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and to convince the gainsayers," the people who are bringing up accusations against you, or not necessarily accusations, but saying what you're saying is false. these gainsayers, you need to be able to exhort them and convince them through sound doctrine. That, and if you have sound doctrine, it means it's complete. It means there's no holes in your doctrine. It means you're able to defend and everything is established and there's an answer for every potential, you know, question that might come up about these doctrines. When it's sound, it's bulletproof. When it's sound, there are no holes in your belief system. Verse number 10, for there are many unruly and vain talkers and deceivers, especially they of the circumcision. So he's saying there's a lot of people out there that are vain talkers and they're deceivers. And he says, especially of the circumcision, the Jews at that time were really guilty of doing this, of spreading a whole bunch of false doctrine and subverting people. In verse number 11, which is where the title of the sermon comes from, whose mouths must be stopped, who subvert whole houses, teaching things which they ought not for filthy lucre's sake. There's a lot of people out there that are teaching doctrine. They're going to be, you know, spiritual leaders. They're going to be going to the Bible and trying to convince you of things that, you know, false doctrines, things that are going to subvert you, that are not going to be good for you, not for your benefit, just because they want to make more money, just because all they care about is your money. And we see that today. Churches like this abound. They're not going to teach on sin. They're not going to preach hard. They're not going to warn you and tell you all the negative things. They're not going to tell you you're doing anything wrong, because all they care about is your money. They want to tickle your ears and just fill up the pews to get, let's see how many people we could have come in here to listen to me, make you feel good so that you could give me more money. Essentially, that's the type of person that we're dealing with here. But it says here, their mouths must be stopped. We don't just ignore this and just let it go. He says, you know what? This needs to be dealt with right away. This needs to be combated. And he says, their mouths must be stopped. Look at verse 12. One of themselves, even a prophet of their own, said, now he's going to quote here what one of these false prophets is saying, what one of these people who are teaching things which they ought not for filthy lucre's sake are saying. They said, the Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, slow bellies. So that's their statement. Now, if you remember in verse number 5, Titus was left in Crete. So the Cretans are the people of Crete. So these are people that he's dealing with directly. So the accusation is against the people of Crete, saying, oh, they're always liars. Yeah, those Cretans, they're liars. They're evil. They're evil beasts. They're slow bellies, you know, just railing on the people of Crete. And this is what the false prophet's saying.
Right.
Verse 13, this is where I think some confusion comes in. He says, this witness is true. He's not saying what the claim they're making is true. He's saying this witness is true. The witness that he's giving, that this is what they said.
Right.
He says, this is confirmed. This is exactly what they're saying. That witness is true. And because it's true, because they're railing on the Cretans, because they're calling them liars and evil beasts and slow bellies, he says, wherefore rebuke them sharply. Not even just correct them. No, he says, rebuke them sharply. Titus, you're in this area. You're in Crete. You need to make sure this is handled. You need to make sure this is dealt with, that these lies don't continue to spread, that there's not a false report given about the Cretans, and that these false prophets are called out for what they really are. And they need to be rebuked sharply, that they may be sound in the faith, not giving heed to Jewish fables and commandments of men that turn from the truth. Unto the pure all things are pure, but unto them that are defiled and unbelieving is nothing pure, but even their mind and conscience is defiled. They profess that they know God, but in works they deny him, being abominable and disobedient and unto every good work reprobate. There are two types of people that I believe the pastor is responsible for rebuking and correcting. One, it's those that are saved, but they're all screwed up and they're wrong. Like you might have somebody here that's just got sucked into these Jewish fables and is preaching things that he ought not to preach, and he's completely wrong about it and needs to be corrected, need to be rebuked sharply. And then there's those who are the false prophets that are completely just doing it for money and don't care about the people at all, and they're preaching damnable heresies. I think both of them are the responsibility of the pastor to make sure that they are keeping these people in line by rebuking them sharply and making sure that their congregations and churches know what the truth really is. Turn, if you would, to Romans chapter 16. These are public rebukes, by the way. This is pointing out specific people and calling out what they're doing and rebuking them sharply for what they've done. Romans 16, look at verse number 17. The Bible reads, "Now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned." Notice that. "And avoid them which ye have learned." Just like in Titus 1, he says, "Holding fast the faithful word as he hath been taught." There's an emphasis on when you receive, when you get saved and you come into a church. I mean, the church you get saved from, especially, I mean, if they were able to bring you to the gospel, you should be learning and listening to them. Now, obviously, the Bible is our final authority. This has all the answers no matter what. But what happens is, I think a lot of times, you know, we experience this is one of the reasons why people don't necessarily come to our church after soul winning, is that we'll go out to the door, we'll give someone the gospel, they'll get saved, and then they end up going to some other church that their family goes to, that their friends go to, or whatever, and they're not sticking around and listening to the good doctrine that's already been brought to them. And this is a problem, but, you know, people have a tendency to do this, and but what we're seeing here is that when you receive good doctrine, you need to mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to that good doctrine. And he's saying mark them, meaning point them out, identify them, and avoid them. And verse 18 says, "For they that are such serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by good words and fair speeches deceive the hearts of the simple. For your obedience has come abroad unto all men. I am glad, therefore, on your behalf. But yet I would have you wise unto that which is good and simple concerning evil. And the God of peace shall bruise Satan under your feet shortly. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen." There is nothing wrong. And see, people get offended by this and get upset when the pastor will call out specific people or leaders in the faith. We were talking about that this morning when I brought up the Born That Way Ministries. And I didn't name all, I think the only name I might have mentioned would have been Bob Gray Sr. because he's involved in promoting this. And there are times when people like that, you say, "Oh, but you know, you shouldn't be this infighting between the fundamental Baptists." Well, you know what? There's times when this needs to be called out and sharply rebuked. And they need to be marked and they need to be avoided when they're bringing in this type of heresy, they're bringing this type of danger into the church, when they've forsaken the good doctrine which they have learned. I guarantee you Bob Gray didn't learn this doctrine as, you know, about this eunuchs and the born that way and all the other nonsense. He didn't learn that growing up himself when he was being taught and trained. There's no way. This is some new thing that came up about this eunuch stuff, and it's a bunch of nonsense to cater to this wicked world. Turn, if you would, to 2 Timothy chapter 4. We're just going to see a couple examples here. And we're going to spend a lot of time in 1 and 2 Timothy. In order to mark the people, they have to be called out by name. If there's someone that needs to be called out because they're teaching things contrary to doctrine, which you've learned, and they're unruly or vain talkers, they're deceivers, they're subverting whole houses and teaching things which they ought not for filthy lucre's sake. These are all the various things that we've seen so far in these passages of people who need to be rebuked and people who are being marked and avoided. 2 Timothy chapter 4, we're seeing an example of this. Paul definitely has marked some individuals. Verse number 14, Bible reads, "Alexander the coppersmith did me much evil. The Lord reward him according to his works, of whom be thou ware also, for he hath greatly withstood our words." So here's someone that is an enemy, someone who's an opponent of the gospel, who's withstanding their words. And he's saying, "Alexander the coppersmith, watch out for this guy. Beware of him. He's already done a bunch of evil to me, and he's withstanding our words, and he's fighting against you. So watch out for him." In 1 Timothy chapter 1, I'll flip back to 1 Timothy chapter 1. Verse number 18, the Bible reads, "This charge I commit unto thee, son Timothy, according to the prophecies which went before on thee, that thou by them mightest war a good warfare, holding faith and a good conscience, which some, having put away concerning faith, have made shipwreck, of whom is Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I delivered unto Satan, that they may learn not to blaspheme. And again, he's calling out the names. You see Hymenaeus, you see Alexander. He's saying, you know what? These guys I delivered unto Satan. So let's, you know, the devil could deal with you. That they may learn not to blaspheme. Because what were they doing? They were blaspheming. They were subverting houses. They were teaching this horrible, you know, horribly false doctrine, whatever that may be. It was blasphemous. And he says, they need to learn better. They need to, you know, and were they saved? I don't know. But they were definitely causing problems. Alexander probably wasn't, but I mean, who knows, right? Don't know exactly what they were teaching. But whatever it was blasphemy. Turn to 2 Timothy chapter 2. We're going to see another example here calling out some specific names. Verse number 14, of these things, put them in remembrance, charging them before the Lord that they strive not about words to no profit, but to the subverting of the hearers. And we need to watch out for this anyways. There's a lot of people that want to just get you into arguments and striving about words that to no profit. Just getting involved in vain arguments, he says, but to the subverting of the hearers. Where you've got two people arguing over something and the hearers are just being subverted as a result of this striving about words to no profit. Verse 15, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth, but shun, means shut it out, have nothing to do with it, shun profane and vain babblings, for they will increase unto more ungodliness, and their word will eat as doth a canker, of whom is Hymenaeus and Philetus, who concerning the truth have erred, saying that the resurrection is past already, and overthrow the faith of some. So now we get a more specific example, but two more names thrown out there, Hymenaeus and Philetus. He's saying their word is eating as a canker. They are, you know, basically having these profane and vain babblings, and what they were doing is they were teaching that the resurrection's past already. Because there's a resurrection to come, the second coming of Jesus Christ, when we're all going to be resurrected, right? Those that are asleep in Christ shall rise first, then those of us which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the air, and unto the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, and so shall we ever be with him. And there were some people, and there's still some people today even teaching this very thing, that, oh yeah, the resurrection, that's past already. We're already in the millennial kingdom, or whatever they want to say, you know, these preterist weird interpretations of the Bible. That are, these men are being called out in the Apostle Paul's day. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, he's saying they're wrong. And they need to be called out, and they're actually overthrowing the faith of some through their false doctrine. This is a big enough doctrine, a big enough issue for Paul to call them out and say, you know what? This is ruining people's faith, saying that the resurrection's already happened. Because the resurrection is our lively hope. That's what we're looking forward to. That's something that's still to come when Jesus Christ comes. I mean, that's a huge part of everything that's going to happen and who Jesus was and what he came for and what he's coming back to do. Right. Now, turn, if you would, to 1 John chapter 2. One thing we need to be aware of and try not to be deceived by, but we need to just understand this, is that there's going to be people that are going to be coming out of this movement, right? We have a movement going on now where there's a lot of younger men that are taking up the torch and that are standing firm on the word of God and that are unapologetically just preaching the truth. And who aren't afraid, who aren't ashamed, who don't care what this world thinks. And it's a great movement to be a part of. And it's exciting to see this happen. But we need to realize and understand that there will be infiltrators whose goal is going to be to subvert souls and to deceive. There's going to be people, and again, it's the wolf in sheep's clothing, wicked people that are going to come in to try to destroy from the inside what's being done for God. This is one of the tactics of the devil, and we need to be not be ignorant of his devices. I'll read this for you in Acts 15, verse 24. The Bible reads, "For as much as we have heard that certain which went out from us have troubled you with words, subverting your souls, saying, ye must be circumcised and keep the law, to whom we gave no such commandment." So there was people in the book of Acts, there was new churches or younger churches, they were being troubled by some people who were coming from this same group of people, right? They had received the gospel from Jerusalem, they received the gospel of the apostles, and now all of a sudden, there's some other people that are coming in that are from that same group, and they were preaching. They said, oh, well, no, you also have to be circumcised and keep the law, which is totally not the gospel. So they're bringing a false gospel in, and they were subverting souls then by preaching them this work salvation. And he says, we gave them no such commandment. We didn't send these people out to do that. They came out from us, but they were not of us. Look at 1 John chapter 2, verse number 18. Little children, it is the last time, and as ye have heard that Antichrist shall come, even now are there many Antichrists, whereby we know that it is the last time. They went out from us, look at this, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would no doubt have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest, that they were not all of us. But ye have an unction from the Holy One, and ye know all things. There's a lot of people that are going to be trying, or some wicked people are going to be coming in and trying to split up the movement, try to deceive people, try to subvert souls, and to gain the trust of the unstable souls. They're trying to beguile the unstable souls. And the tactic that they use is going in, making themselves look like everybody else. Like, oh, here's the group of people that I believe. And, the Independent Fundamental Baptists, I believe that. I feel safe. I feel like I could trust someone who has these labels and who's teaching these things. And, where did this guy come from? Oh, he came out of Hiles Anderson. Oh, he came out of, this Bible college or that Bible college. And then you find out they're teaching all these heresies and all these false doctrines, just like Jack Scott. He's a perfect example. At the Hiles Anderson College, there's an institution that was created doing all kinds of great works in its heyday for the Lord, doing great soul winning and a lot of good teaching and stuff. From what I understand, now look, I've never been there personally, so I don't have firsthand knowledge of this. This is secondhand off of and just seeing the fruit of people who have come out of there and are soul winners and they're doing good things, right? I mean, I can at least see that much. I've seen that firsthand, the fruit of many people who had gone previously in years and decades past that had attended that institution. But then you've got Jack Scott who gets into power and then, he's running the whole show there, and he's the main pastor, and slowly he begins to reveal who he really is when he starts coming out with this stuff like, the King James Bible isn't inerrant. He'll say it's perfect and then uses that with a different definition of perfect and try to say that, well, no, there actually are errors. And he's been real slick with, and then of course ultimately he got arrested for filthy communications and with basically pedophilia, as far as I'm concerned. I mean, it was underage, this teenage girl he was having some relations with and lying about it and just doing all kinds of perversion. And he's been outed, that's been made public, and he went to jail for that. And I don't know what's going on. I don't follow it that much, but he's a perfect example of someone who was part of the group, came out from that crowd, but he wasn't of them. He was wicked on the inside. The guy's a false prophet. The guy's a reprobate. I mean, you can see everything that he did and all the lies that he told and trying to fit in and look like that's where he belonged, and then coming out with all of his heresies and all the subverting tons of souls. They went out from us, but they were not of us. And as he says, if they were of us, he said they would no doubt have continued with us. These people who are sent out to preach and they've been trained and they're starting these things, girls, sit still. You've already been founded in your faith. You've already learned the sound doctrine. You're not just going to go off the deep end and start changing everything that you believe unless you never believed it to begin with. I mean, something as foundational as the Word of God, you're not just going to go and start changing your mind about all this stuff. He says, if you were of us, they would no doubt have continued with us, but they went out that they might be made manifest that they were not all of us. And these are the types of people that need to be called out. These are the names that need to be named. It's there's nothing wrong with that. You know, we have a tendency, too much of a tendency actually, in churches and, you know, to try to sweep things under the rug as if nothing ever happened. That happens all the time. You get someone who's found guilty of usually it's sexual perversion or something like that. Some youth pastor, some assistant pastor, some pastor, you know, they're guilty. They get caught doing all kinds of perverted wickedness. And then what do they want to do? Oh, let's not talk about that. Or the, even worse, they'll just send them off to live in another state and then go pastor somewhere else and continue, you know, opening up the door for other kids to be abused. Turn back, if you would, to Titus chapter 3. The shorter sermon tonight, but I just want to get this point across. We need to watch out for the false prophets that are subverting souls. And you know, Brother Robert said something this morning too that I think this kind of, I didn't think about this before when I was preparing for this, and you know, we just talked about that today, but this kind of fits in, especially in today's era, in today's day. I'm going to say this, first of all, I listen to other people's preaching sometimes, and I think it's great. I don't think there's anything wrong. I'm not going to tell you not to listen to anyone else, right? Only listen to me. I'm not that full of myself to just say you could only listen to me. However, I will state this. You are a part of this church. If you're a member of this church, we need to have unity within our church. And you ought to be primarily getting your feeding and receiving from this. If you are a member of this church, this is your church. There is nothing, like I said before, I'm going to say it again, there's nothing wrong with listening to someone else to get some other good preaching and stuff, but you should be getting filled here and satisfied here. And the warning is this, that the more churches begin to start, we don't know who might end up becoming like these false prophets or whatever. And as far as I know, there aren't any right now, but like it may be coming up and it'll be a little bit easier when you're not just full on enthralled with somebody else outside of your church, right? I ought to be your pastor, not someone on the internet.
Amen.
But I'll leave it at that. Let's go, have you turn to Titus chapter 3, look at verse number 9. But avoid foolish questions and genealogies and contentions and strivings about the law, for they are unprofitable and vain. And you'll notice in many of the references we already looked at, striving about words to no profit, getting involved in arguments and debates and you know, just arguing back and forth with people that have these wicked doctrines. This is avoid foolish questions, genealogies, contentions, strivings about the law, for they're improbable and vain. Verse number 10, a man that is an heretic, after the first and second admonition reject, knowing that he that is such is subverted and sinneth, being condemned of himself. These people subvert souls and they're subverted themselves. And the heretics, we don't need to waste our time on them. We don't need to just make sure, you know, we don't need to convince them by arguing and debating with them. They need to be rebuked sharply and told that they're wrong and provide just, you know, here's the evidence, but I'm not going to argue. It's not a debate. It's not a, this is up for question. The Apostle Paul, the same thing happened with him. I believe it's Galatians 3 and then whatever the corresponding chapter was in the book of Acts. I forgot what chapter number it is off the top of my head right now. But when they were being called out, when there was this question of, well, what do the Gentiles need to keep, right? They're saying, you know, circumcision or what aspects of the law do they need to keep? He was saying, we gave place to them, no, not for an hour. We didn't give place unto them and to their false doctrine, their heresy, and their works-based salvation. We knew that they don't need to be circumcised. We knew that salvation is by grace through faith. I didn't give them the time of day. But other people had a problem with that, and that's why we called for, you know, the apostles at Jerusalem and called this big meeting and stuff. And Apostle Paul's like, I don't need letters of commendation, you know, from you or to you. He's like, I don't need any of that stuff. I know the word of God. I know this doctrine, and I don't need to argue it with anybody. This is what it is, and it's not up for discussion. It's not up for debate. You prove the sound doctrine without having to get into these arguments with people who are subverted themselves and who are subverting souls. And these are the heretics that we call out. These are the heretics that you point out and say, you know what? Avoid these people because they're just subverting people. You rebuke them for their false doctrine and move on. 1 Timothy chapter 6. Turn if you would to 1 Timothy chapter 6. And then Matthew chapter 10. That'll be the last place I have you turn is Matthew 10. 1 Timothy chapter 6, though, we need to understand that we're in a spiritual battle. There's a spiritual battle raging today. There's many antichrists. There's many false prophets that are out there. And we need to be weary of this and that we're receiving the good doctrine that has been taught to others and that you have been taught. And not to get carried away and tossed about with every wind of doctrine that you come across online. Like I said, as we mentioned this morning, the Born That Way Ministries is just, don't get carried. And I don't think anyone here would. And it's kind of funny because I didn't mention it in the sermon this morning, but it's like anyone with half of a brain cell is not going to be fooled by this. Any normal person. You know who gets sucked into this, though? Are the people who, they're either sodomites or they have, usually it's going to be family members that are sodomites, because it's harder to accept the truth when someone that you might care for is like that, someone who you've known your whole life, someone who's related to you. It makes you not want to believe the harsh truth. Just like people that you might know, family members that have died and passed on, you don't want to think about them burning in hell. I mean, that's not a pleasant thought. You don't want to think about your children or your parents or your brothers or sisters, you know, maybe if they've died or passed on or if they're going to die, you know, like thinking that, oh, they're burning in hell right now. You'd like to think, well, maybe at some point in their life they put their faith in Christ. That's the thought that you're going to want to have. With the sodomites, with that born that way after all ministries, that's going to be the people that they're sucking in. Because they're grasping at straws trying to figure out, well, hey, maybe this is what happened to them. But the problem with that then is, as I mentioned this morning, the Bible's clear on the subject. They've already been given over to a reprobate mind. Now you're just opening up the doors, just, well, maybe we should trust these people, maybe we should, you know, put them in positions of influence around children and whatever else, and you're going to cause way more damage than whatever you might think you're achieving by settling some nerves temporarily for a person who wants to be deceived into thinking that, oh, maybe my child still is redeemable. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 11, but thou, O man of God, flee these things and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called, and has professed a good profession before many witnesses. We need to fight the good fight of faith. And part of fighting the good fight of faith is identifying and marking the enemies. Identifying and marking the heretics. Identifying and marking those that are subverting whole houses. Turn if you would to Matthew chapter 10. And let's face it, it's not pleasant to have to be calling people out, right? Because what you're doing is it's a confrontation. You're saying this person is wicked or this person's a heretic or this, you know. And it's just, I don't know how to explain it. It's just not pleasant. I mean, it's like you're not picking a fight, but you're pointing somebody out and you're just making it public and known. And that alone requires some boldness to do that because you're going to get some backlash. There's going to be people that like these people or whatever and support them. And they're going to be coming back and attacking you. But at the end of the day, we need to be able to speak what's right and say what's right. And when someone needs to be rebuked, they need to hear it. It needs to be out there. It needs to be said. We need to be able to speak true doctrine no matter who may be offended. The reprobate doctrine isn't a pleasant or a popular doctrine today. It's not something I like discussing. We talked about briefly this morning. But if it is sound doctrine laid out in the Bible, then we ought to preach it from the housetops. Just like every other important doctrine from the Bible, it needs to just be out there. Everyone needs to know about it. We're not going to hide it. We're not going to say, oh, here's this great truth, and it's obvious, and you could see, here's all the evidence for this. Let's hide that under a bushel and just push that away and not touch that, because people don't like to hear that. It might upset somebody. It might offend somebody. Matthew chapter 10, look at verse number 24. The Bible reads, the disciple is not above his master, nor the servant above his Lord. It is enough for the disciple that he be as his master and the servant as his Lord. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more shall they call them of his household? Fear them not, therefore, for there is nothing covered that shall not be revealed, and hid that shall not be known. Look at verse 27. What I tell you in darkness, that speak ye in light, and what ye hear in the ear, that preach ye upon the housetops. And fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. Now, mind you, these are the words of Jesus Christ that we were just reading here in Matthew chapter 10. However, Jesus Christ is the Word of God. He is the Word made flesh. Jesus Christ is the embodiment of God's Word. All of the words in Scripture are contained in Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ is contained in those words. What we learn, what we see, the true doctrine that we find in the Bible, in the Scripture, what has been heard in the ear from what we've learned, when God has shown us from His Word, that needs to be preached upon the housetops. The sound doctrine needs to be revealed. It doesn't matter. He says, don't fear them which kill the body, which is just another person. Don't be afraid of what people are going to think, what people are going to say, what people are going to do. If you know something is right from Scripture, if you can see this truth, don't hide it. Don't be afraid of what anyone else is going to do. You cannot live in fear. You are not going to be a good worker for the Lord. You're not going to do anything for the Lord if you're going to be living in fear and afraid of what might happen if you say what you actually believe. Just come out and say it. He's saying, don't fear those people, but you know who you should fear? He says, rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. He's like, fear God. Don't be afraid of these people. God's the one that told you to shout it from the rooftops. God's the one that told you not to hide this information that you have, not to hide the truth. Listen to God and fear him. Don't fear, don't worry about what man's going to do, because if you're doing what God has for you to do, he has the power to watch over you anyways. They are powerless, those that might be fighting and railing against you, to do anything to you unless God's going to allow it, in which case you're in his will anyways. Let's jump down here, verse number 33, Matthew 10, verse 33. But whosoever shall deny me before men, him will I also deny before my Father, which is in heaven. Now look, this isn't talking about salvation. He's not saying, you deny me before men, I'm going to deny you before my Father, which is in heaven. He says, he's still referring to in the context here of these people who aren't doing what he wants them to do. Now, it doesn't mean you're going to be denied entrance into heaven. He says, I'm just going to deny you before my Father. And anyhow, I don't want to get off on that. That's a whole other sermon in and of itself. Let's keep going here. Verse number 34. Think not that I am come to send peace on earth. I came not to send peace, but a sword. For I am come to set a man at variance against his father, and the daughter against her mother, and the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a man's foes shall be they of his own household. He that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Regardless of who it might offend by preaching God's word, you ought not to hold back from the truth of the Bible, or else you're not worthy of him. He's saying that I didn't come to bring peace for everybody, world peace among everybody. I came to bring the truth, and the truth is going to divide people. There's going to be a sword. There's going to be a division made. When you're standing on what's right, guess what? There's people who don't want to hear what's right and don't believe what's right and want to just fulfill the lust of their own flesh and don't care about what God's word says. There's going to be division there. And when they want to go that way and you want to go this way, you can't just compromise and, well, I just won't talk about these things to satisfy you. You're saying you do that, that's like denying his words. You're denying what he has for you. And he says, if you love them more than you love me, so you're not worthy of me. And he that taketh not his cross, verse 38, and followeth after me is not worthy of me. He that findeth his life shall lose it, and he that loseth his life for my sake shall find it. He that receiveth you receiveth me, and he that receiveth me receiveth him that sent me. He that receiveth a prophet in the name of a prophet shall receive a prophet's reward, and he that receiveth a righteous man in the name of a righteous man shall receive a righteous man's reward, and whosoever shall give to drink unto one of these little ones a cup of cold water, only in the name of a disciple, verily I say unto you, he shall no wise lose his reward. Now, why are these rewards given out? It's the last point. Especially there in verse 41, he says, you know, if you receive a prophet in the name of a prophet, you shall receive a prophet's reward. A prophet's reward sounds pretty good to me. I want to receive a prophet's reward. He's saying if you receive that prophet, you're going to receive a prophet's reward. And if you receive a righteous man in the name of a righteous man, you'll receive a righteous man's reward. Why are these rewards given out? Well, what I believe is because these are true disciples of Christ that are facing persecution from the establishment, from the established religions, from the world, from everybody else. They're facing the heat. They're the ones who are actually standing up, preaching the whole counsel of God. They're being fought against on every side. They're not popular, so nobody wants to have anything to do with them. And in fact, they'll actually ostracize people who are going to be associated with them. Just like the Jews were kicking people out of the synagogues if they, you know, mentioned the name Jesus Christ. They were just, boom, you're out, boom, you're out, boom, you're out, right? They didn't want to hear it at all. And anybody who is even remotely associated with that person is going to be looked down upon. There are men of God who are standing up. Don't be ashamed of what they're doing. If you're willing to receive the prophets that are preaching and doing what's right, you'll get a prophet's reward. I was never ashamed the whole time I was attending Faithful Word Baptist Church to say that Pastor Steven Anderson was my pastor. Amen. I wasn't, well, you know, and look, was that a popular thing? No. Especially when the church is getting in the news and there's all this stuff and oh, he hates and all this stuff with Obama and all this stuff with the homos and, you know, and just everything else and all the media attention and everything else that happened. Don't leave the man of God, because he was just preaching what was right, straight out of the Bible. And that's what I believe, and that's what we preach here. I teach the sound doctrine that I have received and that I have learned. And that is true from God's word. But you see, just like today, there are certain men of God whose name is being cast out as evil. Don't forsake those names because you're worried about what people are going to think about you. Receiving them will cause, you know, receiving these men of God that are standing up and fighting for something, like Pastor Roger Jimenez, you know, modern churchianity is going to oust you. They're going to have nothing to do with you. But when that happens, you earn yourself rewards. You're receiving a prophet in the name of a prophet, you're going to receive a prophet's reward. I remember at the Red Hot Preaching Conference, we went out soul winning, and they had been, they were pretty well known. And after all the media stuff, too, at Faithful Word, when I was going out soul winning there for a while, people would be like, oh, I know that, you know, like oh, I know that church. And they don't like it. Now, of course, we try to still give them the gospel. I mean, it's like, hey, it's not, you know, we're here just to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ. But don't forsake them. Don't, you know, don't worry about what the world is going to do. They're going to hate it anyways. Right. We need to be aware, though, just going back to kind of the main point of how scriptural it is for pastors to be calling out the wolves, to be calling out those that oppose themselves, to be calling out those that are subverting houses, to be calling out those who are mixed up in blasphemy and the false doctrine. It's part of his job. Don't be mad at the pastor for calling out someone and say, oh, but I really like that guy. He's doing his job. And sometimes, many times, the job of a pastor isn't the most people-friendly in terms of the masses just loving it and accepting it. But it's something that's necessary and needs to be done. Just as parents need to protect their children, which I preached on this morning, parents have that important duty. The pastor needs to watch over the flock. So the parents are looking out for the predators and for the pedophiles and for people who are going to hurt their children. Well, pastor's basically doing the same thing over you, over the whole group of people that are here today, trying to identify, hey, watch out for this guy, watch out for this guy, watch out for these false prophets that are going to subvert souls. So don't get turned off when the pastor calls out wicked people by name and warns you of them. It's something that's necessary and it's something that is scriptural. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for your clear teachings from the Bible, dear God. A lot of people don't like that. It makes them uncomfortable to hear warnings about other pastors and other preachers being named by name, dear Lord, and called out as being wolves, as being false prophets, God. But it's very important that we could receive the warnings from our pastor, dear Lord, from our whoever that is, you know, the church, our church, obviously, dear Lord, is right here. But we pray that you would please give us all guidance, give us all wisdom, give us all instruction to know right from wrong, to know when we're hearing false doctrines and blasphemies, and then to be able to shun those people and to not have anything to do with them, but rebuke them sharply, dear Lord. So in Jesus' name we pray, amen.